Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video we will be discussing the arterial supply of the brain. And there are going to be two major arteries that supply the brain. And each one of these arteries have multiple branches, some of which we will discuss, specifically those that make up the cerebral arterial circle, more commonly referred to as the circle of Willis. Additionally, we will discuss why having this collateral blood flow is important in terms of maintaining constant blood supply to the highly metabolic brain. So let's start with those two main arteries and talk a little bit about where they came from in terms of branching and how they get to the cranial cavity and brain region. And we will start with the internal carotid artery. You will very often hear us say ICA to abbreviate, which is a terminal branch of the common carotid artery that sits, I hope you remember that common carotid artery that sits in the carotid sheath of the neck. So it was next to the internal jugular vein in the vagus nerve. Recall also that it ends at a bifurcation with two major branches. You will have the external carotid, which is the portion that actually supplies branches to the neck. And then, of course, the internal carotid, which gives off no branches to the neck. That is the external carotid's job. So the ICA will travel a little bit higher into the neck, and it will enter the skull via the carotid canal. It actually has a really complex passage through bone. And recall from a previous learning objective, it will also traverse the cavernous sinus for a distance as well. Eventually, it will make its way to the base of the brain and will be important in terms of what is often called the anterior circulation, meaning it will supply blood to the more anterior portions of the brain. The vertebral arteries are the other main arteries that supply the brain, and these will serve more posterior portions of the brain, such as the brainstem and the cerebellum. And you may recall from earlier in the year that the vertebral arteries are a branch of the first part of the subclavian artery, and it will traverse the neck via the transverse foramina of the cervical vertebrae, specifically the cervical vertebrae C6 through C1. And remember those transverse foramina. Those were those foramina in the transverse processes that really help distinguish a cervical vertebra from the other types of vertebrae. And so its function is to allow for these vertebral arteries to get up to the head. The vertebral artery will actually enter the skull via the foramen magnum, which you can see right here, and it will give off some branches in that area. And near the junction of the pons and medulla, the two vertebral arteries will join, you can see that here, to form the basilar artery. And so often you will hear the more posterior circulation referred to as the vertebrobasilar system. More to come on that in a moment. Now let's discuss a few of the internal carotid arteries branches. And this first one, I really just wanted to introduce here. We will discuss this one in much more detail in the next session. And this is the ophthalmic artery. It tends to be one of the first branches, if not the first branch, of the internal carotid, and will be hugely important in terms of supplying the orbital region and the eye itself. Thus, that's why we're covering it in the next session. Another more distally located branch of the internal carotid is going to be the posterior communicating artery, which is sometimes not even described as a branch of the ICA just because of its function as a connector between the ICA and the posterior cerebral arteries right here and here. And the posterior cerebral arteries are the terminal branches of the basilar artery. So in essence, it is this little artery, this posterior communicating arteries, that are going to be the main connection between the ICA and the vertebrobasilar system. So it's a component of the circle of Willis. The last two internal carotid artery branches I want to discuss are the two terminal branches. And these are going to, we'll start with the smaller of the two, and these are the anterior cerebral arteries. So I'm going to kind of outline them here. So you see, here is your ICA. It's cut on both because you have to do that in order to remove the brain. But the anterior cerebral arteries are very important in supplying, as its name would suggest, the more anterior portions, but also medial and superior portions of the cerebrum. And right before these two arteries begin traveling through the longitudinal cerebral fissure, there is a very small, and I'm going to draw an arrow to it, a very small communicating artery, and I mean very small, and it's referred to as the anterior communicating artery, which in essence serves to connect the right anterior cerebral to the left anterior cerebral. So kind of a connection between the two internal carotid artery branches. The other terminal branches are the larger ones, and these are the middle cerebral arteries. And these serve the more middle or lateral portions of the cerebrum. It's often difficult to see the middle cerebral arteries at the base of the brain without retracting the temporal lobes. These are your temporal lobes being retracted, as you can see in this dissection, so you can see those middle cerebral arteries a little bit better. All right, let's focus. Let's turn our focus to the vertebral arteries, which, as you can see here, here's one, and here's another. These are going to be in close association with the brainstem. These are cut obviously in this dissection, as we're only viewing the brain here, so you don't see the entire course of the vertebral arteries. And the largest branches of the vertebral arteries are the posterior inferior cerebellar artery. So a super long name. It's much easier to call it by its abbreviation, PICA or PICA. You'll hear it either way. And as its name would suggest, it supplies posterior and inferior portions of the cerebellum, as well as portions of the distal brainstem. It will actually be in close approximation of the roots of cranial nerves 9 and 10 as they exit the brain as well. So you'll hear PICA come up a few times throughout the rest of this course. Now, as mentioned before, the two vertebral arteries will join or unite to form the basilar artery. And it's going to occur right around this junction between the brainstem and the pons here. This is going to run, the basilar artery will run in very close approximation to the pons throughout its length. Now, the reason you hear the combined term vertebrobasilar system instead of just vertebral system like you do with the ICA is because the majority of the major branches actually come off of the basilar artery. And there are three that we want you to be familiar with. The first is by far the smallest, and this is the anterior inferior cerebellar artery. Also kind of abbreviated similar to PICA, we have ICA. And this will supply anterior and inferior portions of the cerebellum, as its name would suggest, as well as small portions of the brainstem. So similar to PICA, but difference in terms of where they're going to branch. And then there are two sets of arteries towards the more distal portion of the basilar artery. And there will be the smaller, and I'm just going to kind of outline the smaller superior cerebellars. It's easier to see on this side. I'm going to focus on this side of the brain rather than this one. So the superior cerebellar arteries are smaller. They will supply superior portions of the cerebellum. And then the two terminal branches of the basilar artery are the larger posterior cerebrum, or cerebral, really. I have a nice typo here. I'll fix it in the PowerPoint. So the posterior cerebral arteries are going to supply inferior surfaces or posterior portions of the cerebrum. So it's not the cerebellum in terms of what this artery is supplying. In particular, it's supplying the occipital lobe. So I'm going to outline the posterior cerebral artery here. You see a little stump of a cranial nerve right here. This is actually the cranial nerve 3 or oculomotor that's going to kind of be lodged in between the superior cerebellar and the posterior cerebral arteries. Now, the posterior cerebral arteries are going to be connected to the ICA, as we mentioned, by the posterior communicating artery. And so, speaking of communicating arteries, let's return to the concept of the cerebral arterial circle, more commonly referred to as the circle of Willis. And this area of communication or anastomoses between arteries lies at the base of the brain, as you can see here. We're looking at an inferior surface of the brain. And this region serves to connect the ICA and the vertebrobasilar system by means of that posterior communicating artery. So here's your ICA, here is your posterior cerebral, and that posterior communicating artery is connecting those. The circle also allows branches of the internal carotid to be connected via the very small anterior communicating artery. And I mean small, small. It is difficult to even draw an arrow to the anterior communicating arteries. So an important area of anastomoses, it's going to provide potential detours for blood flow in case the usual pathway is obstructed by, say, compression or occlusion or other reasons for affected blood flow. Now, it's important to note that there can be variability regarding what these branches actually look like. It can be different in terms of caliber of the vessels, but it can also occasionally, these branches can be duplicated or even tripled or could be absent as well. So there's considerable variation in the circle of Willis. As you can imagine, sufficient blood flow is hugely important to the comparatively highly metabolically, metabolically, excuse me, active brain. Sometimes we get tripped up by these words as well. And there can be multiple reasons why specific portions of the brain do not get sufficient blood supply. And this can have huge and sometimes quick implications for acute interruptions unless addressed immediately. And you are going to talk about these two terms in much greater detail in upcoming lectures, but I did want to at least introduce them here because we're talking arteries. Now, when you're talking about just the more generalized term stroke, this just means generically any kind of rapidly developing focal neurological deficit, so not due to seizure activity. And there are really two major means that this can occur. These will be the ischemic and the hemorrhagic strokes. Ischemic strokes occur with a lack of or even just a reduced blood flow to a region of the brain. And this can be caused by a multitude of factors, specifically or kind of more commonly a pathology in the lumen of the artery, such as with a thrombosis or an embolus being stuck in that region, which will occlude blood flow to specific regions of the brain. Hemorrhagic strokes are most commonly caused by a subarachnoid hemorrhage. So a hemorrhage into the subarachnoid space, typically caused by a ruptured aneurysm. And an aneurysm is just kind of a balloon-like swelling of the arterial wall. So if the aneurysm ruptures, this will allow blood to escape into the subarachnoid space. And again, more details to follow regarding strokes, considerable more detail to follow regarding strokes from your clinical lectures. But as we're talking arteries, I did want to at least introduce them here. All right, excellent. We have made it to the summary slide, which should serve as an excellent resource for studying and consolidating your knowledge. Please always, always feel free to reach out to me or any of my anatomy colleagues with questions. And I thank you for your time and attention.